Now, a brief remark on the first issue, plurality and diversity. In my humble reflection, plurality and diversity is inherent in everything in creation. We find diversity in the cosmic order. We find diversity on Earth, the eco-balance, eco-diversity, which is necessary for the sustenance of life. But that applies as well to human beings, whether we're speaking about diverse ethnic group, linguistic group, national groups, and of course, our focus today, that is religious plurality. That's the one we focus on, and most of the time, limited time will be devoted to that. My humble contention is that while I'm not getting into the Sharia and the grave mistakes and misperception about what Sharia is, reduced to penal law, reduced to Islam. In fact, the Quran in chapter 42 used the term that is coming from the same root from which Sharia came to describe the message of the great five prophets, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad. Shara'a lakum min ad-deen. So Sharia is not only for Muslim. It is, in essence, not the detailed laws. In essence, it is the way, because literally Sharia means a path. So in a religious sense, Sharia is the path that lead us to Allah, whether we are Muslim, Christian, or Jews, because the core message of all of the prophets has been one and the same. So my contention basically is that if we look at the maqasid of Sharia, not details that can change with the change of time and place, but the supreme objective of Sharia, its ethical and moral orientation, which a lot of people other than Muslims can also accept and find it resonating with them. That these five or six, actually now some people add a sixth objective of Sharia, is not only intended for Muslims, but for all, because the message of the Quran, when it deals with human beings, it is universal, except for areas that are specific to Muslim, like their prayer and fasting. Now, but in the very outset, I'd like to make it clear. Number one, Sharia is not what Muslims have done, are doing, or will do. Not necessarily. It's not identical. Sharia comes from Allah. It's perfect because Allah is perfect, if we really understand it. Human beings, Muslims or otherwise, are imperfect human beings. They come close or far away from those ideals. Whether those who abide or not abide by Sharia or go totally against Sharia are individuals, groups, or states, for that matter. A second point, that Sharia is not identical with judicial ruling in general or with a specific fatwa. These are often mistaken, and sometimes I have my reservation even on the term Sharia law, because sometimes when we speak in the terms of law, we speak about some detailed laws, but that's not what Sharia really is all about. In the Arabic terms, it is mixing up the term Sharia with fiqh, which means jurisprudence. There's no time to elaborate on that, but I just want to make it clear in my mind at least. Thirdly, that as classical jurists put it very clearly, that ultimately, if you want to summarize what Sharia intends to do, they used a very beautiful sentence, جَلْبُ الْمَنَافِعُ وَدَفْعُ الْمَضَارِ, to bring benefits and well-being to humans and to remove the harms. And now some people think that Sharia is a monster. The ultimate end of Sharia is to bring prosperity and goodness to human and remove or at least mitigate some of the harms that happens to them. That's the essence of it. These are manifest or embodied in the five common, or let's say six main or supreme objective of Sharia, and I'd like for you to think as I'm speaking as to whether you can relate to that in principle, not in details or application. The first one, and that is actually the first in the hierarchy, that Sharia is about protection of faith. Faith here does not mean Muslims, as some people may think, and the evidence comes right from the Quran itself. When the Quran speaks about God or Allah in Arabic, actually, it speaks about the God of all. So it's not some people fighting on behalf of their God about some other God. God is the Lord and creator of all. When the Quran speaks about the mission of all prophets, it is generic Islam, achieving peace with Allah, inner peace and peace with all creation of Allah, humans, animals, vegetation, ecology, through willing and loving and trusting submission to the Creator, something I think resonates with many believers, especially in the Abrahamic faith. So when we talk about protection of faith, then we're not talking only about Muslims. The Quran is more explicit even. And it's not in verse 256, the famous one in chapter 2, let there be no compulsion or coercion in religion. There are many, many other ayat in the Quran emphasizes the same thing. That is protection of faith of a Muslim, of a Christian, even idolatrous person, because idolatry is mentioned in the Quran as deen, lakum deenukum. This is your religion or way of life. Even idolatrous are regarded as having deen. All are entitled to the protection of what appeals to their conscience, their heart, and their mind. But the Quran goes beyond that to even mandate the protection, not just to recognize they can believe, but you cannot practice. You can practice your faith, and the Quran speaks about actually the protection of places of worship and begins with places of worship of other than Muslims even. Not only this, it goes beyond that to invoke and encourage the interfaith dialogue in peace and respect among all to discover the common ground, and there are many. But there is something that you don't find even in modern democracies, that there is special consideration are given to religious minorities concerning their personal law, that they don't have to follow the law of the land, not when criminal law, crime is a crime, in the matter that is so much attached to religion like the personal law. The second is protection of human life. And when the Quran speaks about human life, it speaks in an inclusive way, not only the lives of Muslims. Jurists said that protection of life is not only to protect from murder. Actually, it is to provide also for the necessities of life and also to prescribe certain punishment for those who aggress about the lives of others. But the rule of evidence is very high. And the family of the deceased may forgive, and the person will not be, for example, punished for murder. Something, again, that does not exist in our contemporary legal system, forgiveness on the part of the family. The third one is to protect mind and reason, both on the positive and negative sense. Positively, by encouraging people to seek knowledge, to demand evidence, not to just be misled by myth or unsubstantiated claims. And that might be at the root, perhaps, of the emergence of Islamic civilization and its immense contribution to humanity. They were motivated, actually, by the Quran, as I argued in a different paper. But also on the negative side, Islam prohibited anything that beclouds and ultimately destroy the power of reasoning, the greatest gift of Allah, the mind. Fourthly, to protect the family or progeny. As the cornerstone of society, there are rules about equality, full equality between the genders, equity in terms of role differentiation, but interdependence between both, about marriage as love, peace, and compassion, child protection morally and otherwise. The fifth is to protect property, the right to work and earn, acquire wealth and use it legitimately and morally, teaching against all forms of cheating and injustice. But it requires also fulfillment of the basic needs of people before you punish. And there are numerous examples in history about that. The sixth and the final one, the protection of human dignity, or ird. This is also derived from the Quran, from the concept of dignity of the human. And dignity, as mentioned in the Quran, is not the exclusive right of Muslims. It says, Bani Adam. Allah says, we ennobled the children of Adam, which includes everybody, even those who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or believe in him. Protection of ird, then, or human dignity, includes protection of reputation of the individual from slander and false accusation or character assassination, and also to provide for equitable social order and well-being of all. Just to conclude, very quick points. One, diversity and plurality is part of God's will in all creation. Two, theological truth statements in the Quran, like other religious scriptures of other religion, should not be forced on anyone or used as a pretext for persecution, violence, or injustice. Thirdly, failings and deviation by Muslims in their own is their own responsibility, not to be blamed Islam, not on Sharia, which actually is for the good of humanity. Fourth and finally, there is a great and dire need for fair, objective, and comprehensive evaluation, even when we come to evaluation of historical practices of any community of faith, Muslims and otherwise, looking at the positive things without romanticizing one's history, but without denigrating that history and see nothing but the isolated cases of wrong that was done. We thank you very much for your attention. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.